Hello?
She's recording. Okay, so we're gonna get started with our data mining tutorial. And I have this very generic name, data mining. I don't know what I meant by it, but I think it's more of a machine learning tutorial. But I'll tell you exactly what we plan to do today. So first, the materials are on JupyterHub. You can follow them using the notebooks. You can also just look at them if you want the correct. Let me just send the link. Or maybe somebody else can do it. Send the link on Slack. Just make sure you know which notebooks to look at. And the plan for today is, so basically I have a data set of some whale sounds. And this data set was actually shared as part of a Kaggle competition, actually now 5 years ago. And for those who haven't heard of Kaggle, Kaggle is a platform which often has these competitions. And they share some data set, which usually is pre-processed quite a lot, to get it into a form that anybody can go and start working with it. So you don't really. Usually, you don't really need to be a domain scientist. So I took one of those data sets. And for that data set, they actually, for this challenge, they're trying to identify right whale upcalls. So they're kind of, the data set was split into like small chunks. And some of them had upcalls, and some of them didn't. And there's also label data, because somebody annotated it. So that kind of could help guide people how to find these upcalls. And what is the goal for us? The goal for us is, I have a few things here written up. And I'm using this data set, but my main goal is to just kind of try to make you think of, you know, how to approach a problem anytime. You know, you have a different data set, so don't think that this is just for like a whale calls. Anytime you have some oscillatory data or like some time series, you know, you have to kind of go through the same steps. Actually, for other data sets too. So I'll kind of walk you through a standard pipeline of doing machine learning. My goal is not to even show you the best method on this data set, which I think further down I have a reference to some people who actually had pretty high scores. But that was 5 years ago, so by now those scores are already old, so it doesn't matter. But the goal is just to show you how to use very standard tools when you get a new data set and you try to decide what to do with it. And here are our objectives. So we're gonna, because we have audio data, we have to first do some manipulation to just get this data and kind of convert it to a format so that you can actually start applying more standard machine learning data mining tools. So we're gonna first do some unsupervised exploration. So we won't use the labels. And then we're gonna go and try to use the labels and see how they help us. And then we're gonna try several methods. And my main goal would be not to actually explain the methods, but to actually explain to you how to evaluate the methods. Because there are just so many methods that you need to kind of like, we need to go for a whole semester on methods. And although I think it's important, I think it's more important to understand how to evaluate them. So when you have two of them, how to decide what to do with them. Okay. So that's kind of the plan. And this is our, so pretty much if you go to day four, we have data mining. And we have this first notebook, which is zero, which all that this notebook does is some manipulation of the data. So we're gonna go through it kind of quickly because it's not, you know, it's a little bit specific for the whales, we want to understand our data set so that we move forward. So what do we have? So actually, so first you can see that, let me make this bigger and wider. So first I'm just loading a lot of libraries that we'll need later on. As you see, NumPy, Matplotlib, and so on. And the files, let's actually have a look. Actually, this, I have to put some extra dots here to show me the right. So pretty much we have a folder which is train, we have a folder which is test, and we have the CSV files contain the labels. Don't worry about looking what's inside. We're gonna do it through Python. And usually the way these challenges work, you are given first only the training data. So you are not gonna see this data here. And so you have to work with your training data. And so in a sense, you pretend you haven't even seen these data, because until they finish the competition, or until you actually do a real world thing, right, you won't have the truth. So, you know, like you pretty much can ignore that for now. So we're just gonna use this train data from here, and we're gonna read it, and it turns out that there are 30,000 files. And all these files are in this format, which is called AIFF, which is just an audio format. I actually didn't know about it. As Rob showed earlier, we can actually play audio files in the Jupyter notebook. If it was MP3, we could have directly played it. But we have to do a few steps because it's AIFF, and maybe it's not so popular. But anyway, so let's first just read these files. So pretty much we're gonna get a lot of files. And we're gonna get the labels, and we see that the labels are pretty much, you have the name of the file and the label, so that's it. So this is our labels. And for the files, here I'm kind of doing a few steps to, so I'm just opening one individual file so you get a sense of what's there. So let's do that. So it's train 6. And if you see here, train 6 is one of these that has a whale call. So let's just look at it for a second. And we read it directly with the, so I imported AIFC library to read this file. So it's very specific, right? But it's okay, it can read it, and we can get some information about it. We get how many frames, and we get the frame rate. And for some conversion here, it's not that important what it is. But we can actually get it to a NumPy array, and we can plot it. So that's kind of the main point. And as you see, you know, it's a noisy, it's oscillatory thing because it's a sound. And I converted the type. So as I mentioned, if you have MP3, you can directly use this. So if we look here, we can use this pretty much functionality of the Jupyter notebook to play files in it. And somebody succeeded. because it was not MP3, I had to convert it to a NumPy array first. So that's the whole thing. But just keep in mind that so there's more and more. Okay, I'll do it. Okay. Anyway, you get the point. They kind of have a little bit like up sound, and you can listen to them, and you hear that some of them, you can distinguish with your ear that some of them have like an up sound, and some of them don't. I inspected some of them, and I believe that the label data is wrong, but I might ask some experts to verify that. So anyway, we might have some errors in the label data, but we'll just treat it as ground truth. All right, so now that you know that you have sound, how do you normally deal with data sets like that? Anybody want to say what they, if they get this kind of data, how did they manage it? Yes? Spectrograms. Any other approaches of dealing with it? Only spectrograms. That's good, because they look good. Okay, so here I have a little function to show the spectrogram in Python. But the main point is that they're like 2-second snippet, and these are the frequency. And this is sort of the sound. So in a sense, there is a feature in this image that corresponds to the whale call. Okay, so if we convert it from, so pretty much if you try to do some sort of data mining or machine learning on this oscillatory data, I think most methods will fail, right? Because there is a lot of frequency information and there is offset up and down. So aligning two data sets like this makes no sense. There's going to be always, you know, there's not going to be corresponding information. So the information is more in the frequency. So I'll just add another approach. Sometimes you can do some filtering, like Welch filtering. And I think in one of the examples down, further down, I use that approach. So instead of spectrogram, you can take that approach. But yeah, usually you have to do something before you jump using your data. And kind of here I'm making the point, usually when data comes from actual scientific kind of like observations, I think in many cases it doesn't come in a format where they give you traditional machine learning tutorials. So in a sense, you have to do a little bit to convert it. I think most of you have experienced that. So okay, so we'll start working with the spectrogram because it's intuitive. And what we'll do is we'll pretty much go ahead and extract the spectrogram for each of these files. And that's what happens in this next section. So then the details don't matter. In the end, pretty much you're doing a loop and you're running this function and you're getting a spectrogram for each file. So I'll run that. And I decided, if you wonder, I decided to put to only use 10,000 files so that we don't overwhelm the system. So I think it should be okay. Okay, so I do some manipulation. And one important thing is that once you have a spectrogram, how do you work with it? Well, a lot of methods expect you to have a vector for each observation. And a spectrogram is not a vector, right? It's actually it's two-dimensional array. So there's two things to think about, is like how you want to deal with the time information, how you want to deal with the frequency information. You can try to think of it as spatial information and maybe apply some spatial methods to deal with that. Or you can treat it as a vector. And actually, for the first part, I'll actually just treat it as a vector, which is we're ignoring like a lot of kind of like time information and frequency information. They're still stored in the vector. We just don't use the order. So and it actually it's still, you know, like it can provide useful information. So what I do here is I use this function which is called Ravel, which pretty much takes a two-dimensional array, which is our spectrogram, and makes a very long vector of it. So you can say, well, that's kind of stupid. You know, why do you use all of this? Well, you have to think about, you know, like if you try to use it as a spectrogram, you have to do more work. So let's just first convert it to a vector and deal it as a long feature vector, which after all these modifications, what we get is, yes. Yes, so I pretty much the way the files came, they were already the same length, which simplified things. Because then when I created the spectrograms, they're also the same size. It's a good question of how they chunk them so that, you know, like kind of the optimal decision of, you know, how to deal with overlaps and so on. But for now, we just kind of treat them as fixed. So what is the problem of ignoring time? Anybody can say? I mean, in terms of this picture, you know, I could have another picture where the call is kind of to the right or to the left, right? And yeah, so there is, you know, they possibly could appear anywhere. They could be shifted, right? And now we are not accounting for that. And I'm going to say how you can account for that later on. But for now, we're just going to assume that they're more or less somewhere in this picture. OK, So we have this long vector, which kind of looks meaningless here, but it did store all the information of the spectrogram. And just to say that in general, we're going to use the scikit-learn library and everything in, well, not everything, but a lot of things in this library or any other libraries, they expect you to put your data into this format, which, as we said, it's very limiting. It's not taking care about the, you know, like all the information we have from the ocean and so on. But okay, let's just try to do it this way. So they expect you to have observations as rows and columns are features. So the spectrogram became a feature. And here I'm just doing a little bit of cleaning and I'm saving these. So in the end, I'm just saving the spectrograms as a big X and the labels as Y. And from then on, we can kind of use more more standard tutorials on how to deal with this kind of data. So, all right, so does that work? Did this all work so far? Okay, so this is just the loading notebook. As I said, we can call it feature extraction, but we didn't even extract anything very complex. So we just got the spectrograms out. All right, so let's go to the second notebook. And in this notebook, we'll just explore the data a little bit and see what's there. Okay, so first I'm just gonna run through these libraries, which, and kind of the step here, I'm gonna bring back this data. So I call it XY, now I just care about XY. I lost all other useful information. And there is a very nice picture, like actually again, that was again 2013, so about the time where the challenge was, of trying to summarize the methods that were in scikit-learn around that time. And this graphic is still active because everything is still relevant. So now if you click here, they even made it kind of interactive and you can click and learn about the different methods. So it kind of goes you through this and depending on your situation, helps you decide what methods to choose. And they split it into, as you see, like several categories. And for now, we're gonna do a little bit dimensionality reduction because we're not gonna use the labels. And then we're gonna do classification because we're gonna use the labels. If you have continuous variables, you need to do regression. And if you want to do some unsupervised grouping, you need to do clustering. So I guess that kind of, that's how they split it. So here I'll say something that in general, when you approach a data problem, I think it's very important to identify what kind of problem you're solving, you know, first, before jumping into the data. Because once you kind of get, maybe it's one of these four problems. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's a fifth problem. But once you know where you are, you know how to approach it. Sometimes you jump a little bit, and then you realize you don't know what problem you're solving. So that's my advice. Try to put it into a, some standard form. OK, so we have a lot of methods here. But for dimensionality reduction, pretty much you have to start with principal component analysis. There are many cases where it might not work, but I would always try that and see what it gives me. So how many people have used PCA before? Okay, so a lot of you, right? So it's kind of the first thing you try. It gives you a good sense of the data. So in a sense, what is PCA? PCA just kind of takes the data and transforms it into a new coordinate system so that we find the directions of most variation. And as I said, I'm not really gonna explain the methods much today, but I'm gonna be a little bit more technical of what does it give me. Okay, so what does it give me? So applying these methods is very easy in scikit-learn. So for like dimensionality reduction, usually a lot of them are in this sklearn decomposition subcategory. So you just do import PCA, and you can run this line. This line specifies your setup. So I want to maybe decide number of components. And then I get my data and I applied a log to it because the numbers were really big. So that's why I applied a log. And I'm just fitting this transform. So I'm transforming this to the new coordinate system. So long story short, what I get out of this, as I'm saying, I'll be just technical. I do get a new variable which is lower dimensional, but hopefully it stores the same information. Okay, so we see we got X transformed. The dimensions are 10,000. This is the number of observations. And 30 is the number, the new dimension, right? Yes. This is kind of initializing the map, the second line, right? Okay, so PCA is kind of like a class, actually, technically, it is a class, and you initialize it with, so pretty much here you set the parameters. So you initialize it with number of components, and copy is true. Yeah, so then I can use this little PCA. So that's why it's big PCA, little PCA. Then I can use this object, so that it created an instance of this class. And I can use this and do PCA. So now my, if I come here, I have these extra functions. So I have the actual fit transform. Some other functions get covariance and so on. Components is like actual object of this. So pretty much every time you're gonna do manipulation with PCA from now on, everything gonna be stored in this object. So, yes. I hit tap, I think. Tap. No. What did I do? Yeah, tap.
Okay, so could you just start from a blank line and show all the keystrokes to get that directory listing? Because that's been really valuable.
Okay, so I just did PCA dot and tap.
Okay.
Yes. So the I'll say a little bit about this. You see how some of them are functions? Some of them have this underscore. The underscores they are actually like actual variable, like sort of like objects within this class, like variables. So this is how you distinguish things. And I can show you below. We are using one of these variable PCA components. So it's just if we do type. It's just an array. So what we got is we split it actually in two parts. We had the data CX, and we have X transformed, which is 10,000 by 30. And we have PCA components, which is, we see what it is. It's 30 by 3, 5, 4. Zero. This was the number of elements in the spectrogram. So this was the other dimension. So pretty much we decomposed the original data into something which we call components and something which I called X transform, but another way to think about it is coefficients, because now these coefficients correspond to these components. And I'm not getting into the kind of the geometry, but let's just think that we get these new variables. Okay, so why did I pick 30? Anybody want to say why did I pick 30? Can you say it louder? That's actually more scientific than I wish that was the decision for that. But it did explain, I looked at how much of the variance it is explained, but I looked at the picture. I didn't even like look at the values. So I looked at the elbow plot, and I was looking for the elbow in the plot. And if we look at, so this is the plot of the singular values that come from the method, and pretty much wherever you find like a some sort of elbow, you can kind of stop there. But I actually kind of wanted to switch to decay, so I could see that there's still some going on. So I stopped at 30. But you know, I don't have to use all these. And we can look at the explained variance, as you said. So let's read here. We have, as I said, we have all these ones. We have explained variance ratio. We should do ratio. And we see that we don't start from very high. Sometimes you really have like large dimensional data set, and it's really like you get 90. Here we see that you cannot, you know, it's not that simple. And we'll see later, it's not that simple to kind of get it into a few dimensions. Okay, so let's also visualize what these components mean. As I said, these are sort of directions of large variation. And with this whole step here, I'm just plotting stuff. So you don't have to worry about it. I just want to plot everything. And these are the first 10. And as you can see, this is some sort of background. This is some layer below, layer midway. These start to look like these start to look like whale calls. But then they're vertical lines. And you know, it's not that obvious that it's not one component corresponding to whales and everything else to background. So this is just kind of, you know, usually I think a lot of things when people do this dimensionality reduction, they also explore the data. So they don't just jump to automatic conclusion. They kind of go back to it. And I kind of looked at it actually for a while, figuring out what's going on. So yeah, I think there is signal here. We can definitely see some of these correspond to whales. But there is a lot of other things going on. And this is where the, you know we have a problem because we're not really doing anything with the background. It's there, right? We don't account for these lines and so on. OK, so I'll just say here, and I think you can kind of try on your own after that. So usually when I kind of go and try to do PCA, in scikit-learn, it's actually very easy to do a lot of other methods because they follow exactly the same syntax. So pretty much, if you substitute PCA to some other method, you can follow the same steps and obtain the corresponding components. So these are all linear decomposition methods. And NMF states for non-negative matrix factorization, independent component analysis. Some of you, if you worked a lot with kind of like audio data, people use it a lot in that field. So, and there are some other ones there, like dictionary learning methods and so on. So you can go to scikit-learn and find them all somewhere. So they're all under the same. I think this was a good tutorial, maybe. So there's a lot of them. And then they discuss the differences and so on. OK, but I won't get into that. It's just good to know that once you try one, you can do the other ones and see what's going on. And maybe. I'll send this. Does anybody have problem with the data? We downloaded the data, some of us earlier. I just want to make sure that people do have the data. OK. All right, so let's get back to what we are doing. So let's try to understand what we did. So now that you have this low dimensional representation, you can actually try to plot it to understand it. But we can only see in two or three dimensions. It's a little bit hard to see in higher dimensions. So for the first thing, let's just try to visualize the first two components, since they correspond the most variation. And we want to see whether they represent something. OK, so here, we don't need that, I think. So here I'm just taking this transformed data, and you remember we had 30 components, but you don't have to look at them all at the same time. So I can just look at the first one and the second one, and I'm going to use the labels to visualize them, although I said I'm not using the labels to decide something. I'm just going to superimpose them to see whether there is any kind of like whale information when I plot it. So I'm not really, I'm just visualizing stuff. So this is what we get. This is just first and second component. And we can see that the whale calls are kind of a big blob here. And this one is a bigger blob. And, you know, like clearly they don't split as two classes, which would have been ideal, right? But on the other hand, at least they stay together. So from this, I kind of conclude that, well, two dimensions, it's a little bit too little to describe this data set. We could see it even from the variance, you know, like we're not getting so much. We're getting around 70% explanation with the first two components. So there is still some meaning, but I don't know what. That's kind of what I would say. And so then you try to, usually you try to understand, well, what is the meaning then? What does these components mean? And one way to do it is by stealing a function from the internet. And I stole this whole function. And so that you can just ignore what it is doing. But you can, with this function, you can superimpose your spectrograms on the plot so that you can start looking and see what these directions mean by looking at the pictures. So okay. Oh, this is another function. Oh, okay. So, and it's taking some time because it's plotting each of these little snapshot of the spectrogram. So that's why it's gonna take a little bit of time, but we kind of saw it, and we can wait for some time. Do you have some questions in general, like kind of how to deal with these methods? Troubles while working with these methods from before? Okay. So what do we have? No, but I'll show you how you can do it. Not on this one. This one is static. We can zoom in, I think, by just making it bigger. Yeah, so I'll show you something. I'll scroll down to just show you something that I think, actually, this is a little bit motivated by the previous hack cable array hack week, which was only 3 days. And we're a little bit working on that, and we wanted something interactive, but we couldn't find something interactive. And then later, I found maybe here. I found that thing, which is what I wanted during the hackathon. So this is now 3D interactive, but it doesn't have pictures, because this is just some text data set. But if you come here, you go to the MNIST with images. And it takes time because it's a big data set. And it's something that was originally done by Google, and then they open sourced it. And then some interns worked on it to improve it. So anyway, I think with this you can zoom in. I think it's a little bit too much maybe. But it's cool. So maybe we need an intermediate level, and maybe we can develop this in the next days. But this is open source, and this is based on a library which is called FreeJS, which is a JavaScript library, which is good for things like that. And so I think now people can actually, there's this option to just download your own data. It requires a few things to do. You can talk to me if you're interested. But I think if you want to develop your own version, most probably you can just modify something that it's not so much you know, like maybe something midway. But I think that actually does help explore to understand what's going on. Okay, so I'll close this. But with this 2D thing, which is just 2D, as we said, I kind of looked at it, and at least what I was happy with, make it smaller. Oh, this is the different data set. Okay, so it's this one. So at least I could see that, you know, these have like a layer on top. So in this direction, I guess it's layer on top. And these had a lot of vertical lines. So in this direction are all the ones with vertical lines. So these are maybe some pinks and stuff. And then here where the yellow ones, clearly those are where the coals are. And that's pretty much I could get out of it. But you know, like you get the sense that at least the transformation keeps them together. You know, like so the patterns stay together. But maybe it's not, you know, like so you can get a sense of what's happening in each direction. And you can do the same thing for different. So we just did it for the first two components, but you can maybe try one of the whale components and see how that works. So actually, why don't you spend, like, I'll give you, like, 3 minutes to try some of the other components, right? All we need to do is pretty much change where we were plotting. We are deciding 0, 1. Maybe you explore a little bit based on the upper picture here, some other visualizations, and see whether you find something. But just so that you try to actually get used to it. Can you do git fetch?
I tried and it gave me some.
Git fetch upstream? Because we changed the names and maybe something.
Do I have to be in it? I have to be in the directory, right?
Yes.
Is there something I can just to kind of like obliterate the whole thing?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Oh, not the git repository.
I may have like tried to.
Can you do git log?
What's that?
Just to get the history. See what happened with the history. Something happened. Somehow.
I may have deleted files that were required. So, can I just like start over? Like, can I just like?
Yeah, you can get out of this folder.
Uh-huh.
And maybe rename it. We can rename it as old. Oceanhackweek is old. And you know that this is the one that something went wrong. And then you can. Can you? Maybe it's just move MV, not rename.
Okay.
What about that? And now you can just do a regular git clone on the main. And you can, if you want, you can even do, and just, okay, for now, let's just clone from the main one, and you'll get the latest version. Did you have also a problem with the? Oh, that's a, maybe just doesn't.
But I don't, I mean, August 20th, it hasn't updated.
But I think in your case, he's having a different error.
Okay.
In your case, if you do git space remote, actually no, let's backtrack. Can we do branch?
Git branch.
Branch, yes. Dash.
Yeah,
a little bit more. Dash R to see the remote ones.
Dash R?
Yes. So I think you have. So can you do git fetch upstream master? Make sure we get that.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Can we do this command again? So I think now, yeah. So now you're gonna do git. So now we got the latest version in this temporary thing, and you're gonna check it out, and you're gonna work from there.
Okay.
So if you do git check out space dash b for branch with space upstream slash master. Oh, and so can you backtrack? And we're gonna call it a name. Maybe call it temp folder. Temp branch. I don't know. Okay, whatever.
And call it upstream. Which one?
Master. So that branch will now has the latest version. And let it go wrong. Oh, because you have some local files.
We can blow them away.
We can also make a branch for them if you want. If you don't want.
I don't need
okay.
them.
Okay. So then you can do just git stash. And in case something is missing, you can search for it in the stash. But for now. And now do the same thing.
This?
Yes. Okay. So I think now you're good, and maybe you have to refresh to get the new things.
Can I refresh here?
Yes.
I try and get fetch upstream, but it says there's no upstream.
I had that problem too.
Do you have it? Do you have
I've just been pulling it.
Remote.
I haven't said any branches or anything.
So I think you need to add git add remote. So.
Oh, add remote upstream master.
Git add. Git remote at upstream and the whole directory name. Did you set up it when we were earlier?
I was using my own repositories. I wasn't
doing
it on the
Hackweek
one.
Makes sense then. So just then, so maybe then you just pull from origin, because most probably there your origin is the Oceanhackweek.
Right.
So then just do git fetch origin master. Did that work? That should save it in a local one.
Yeah, but I still don't see any of the data.
Yeah, for the next step is git. Can we do git?
So it's like up to date with origin master. Should.
Okay, so can you do git remote dash b? Okay, so this is the Oceanhackweek. And can you do git branch dash r?
Oh.
Okay, so I think this should be your latest. Let's check out this one, origin master. So
it's already pointing to origin master there? So, okay.
So can you do git checkout dash b?
Origin master.
First, you need to name it. We're going to call it temp branch. And then origin master. And we see whether it, when
like
you
that origin master like that?
Yes. So now you're going to be on this temporary branch and refresh and see if things look refreshed.
Okay.
And you remember that you're on this branch where everything should be up to date, but later we can decide what to do. I think that should be good. Yeah.
And where is the whale?
We're here now, dimension now.
Yeah, no, I was able to get the notebook, but when I run through this one, I
Oh, do you have the data?
The data, yeah.
Do you have the data?
I don't know. I guess not.
Oh, okay. So there is a W get. I'll send it on. I'll
send
oh,
is that in the Slack?
You remember there is a. Okay. So there is something
on
Slack.
Oh, this whale data zip one?
Yeah. So do that. So maybe that was missing. Okay. All right. So anybody discovered anything interesting between these components? Yes? No? Which one separate most? No decision? It's hard, right? So maybe you kind of try that. I have this function here, which if you try to do a lot of these combinations, this versus that, this versus this, then it's very useful to use this scatter matrix. And this pretty much, it's kind of like a pair plot. It takes each, so I take all the 10, kind of the 10 dimensions, and I plot them pair by pair. So that's kind of very good for exploration. It works for other data sets, right? Not just for dimensionality reduction. And so we do that, and we can kind of get a sense whether some of them split better or not. But as we said, it's not that obvious, and that also takes time because it's a lot of combinations, right? So we let it go. I will say a few other words that are important. So as I said, all these methods, ICA, NMF, PCA, they're all linear methods. So they pretty much get your data and find some projection. Sometimes that's not good enough. Maybe your data is kind of warped. So sometimes a nonlinear method can actually separate your data better than a linear one. So I just throw in one example of a nonlinear method just so that you have one in your toolbox. But there are a lot of other ones. And this one is called TSNE. And became popular kind of more recently. There have been methods that have been there since the 50s that are very well known. But this became popular when the large data sets started to come in. And some of the older methods were not working very well, actually, anymore. So this method actually had a very efficient way to find this decomposition. And it could be parallelized. So people started using it quite a lot. Whether it gives the right decomposition, that's a very hard question. And it's very tricky for all these dimensionality reduction methods, especially when you go to nonlinear. You can warp it the way you want and get whatever you want. But anyway, let's just go through one example. And as you see, now we're just doing manifold. So that's the only difference. But more or less, everything is the same. So once you get to here, and this was taking time, but you can see the picture below. It actually took 3 minutes. And as I'm saying that, as soon as you start doing nonlinear dimensionality reduction methods on big data sets, it starts to take a lot of time. I ran it on the full data set, 30,000, and it took 1 hour. So it doesn't even scale linearly. So it scales, kind of scales with the RAM, more or less. But anyway, these become tricky problems. On speed, I'll say one thing about PCA. If you have a very large data set, sometimes it's, you know, a good question is what do I do if I cannot, you know, like if PCA hangs on me. So there are some, if we go back to the help, there are some few things that scikit-learn is doing to help us actually. Let's get back here. Maybe here. So if we just do help PCA. Oh, we're waiting. Yeah, if Jupyter cooperates, sometimes it's stubborn. Did you try that? Maybe you try that. It's supposed to be 3 minutes. Oh, mine got canceled. And I just want to show you regarding PCA big and big arrays, which is handy. So okay, maybe it's not so much information here. Maybe we just go to the website. I'll just say it. So basically, when you get a big array, there are some methods which are called randomized PCA. And what they do is they actually don't use all your data, which kind of sounds bad because you collected all these data, and suddenly the method decided not to use these data. But the advantage is that they do it randomly. So this randomization actually, it can be proved that you can get the same performance if you use all the data, more or less, with some small error, usually as long as the distribution is more or less the same. So they actually perform really well, and that's what sometimes scikit-learn and NumPy use under the hood to do either PCA or like singular value decomposition. So they pretty much randomly extract rows from your metrics and do some stuff and pretty much get the same result. So don't worry about it. This is very handy. And if you have data that cannot be even fit into your RAM, so you cannot even open it, a lot of people were talking in the previous days about Dask in a little bit more in the context of X-Array and like netcdf files, but actually Dask is very useful for numerical operations, just like base numerical linear algebra. So if you have just some sort of like complex matrix multiplication which hangs your laptop, you can try Dask and see what it can help you. Okay, so I'll stop here on that. And we're gonna go to, so I think you can see the pictures, and I stopped it, but the picture is here. So Tisney is kind of doing these more windy things. In general, it can kind of find its own clusters on its own. So it's, you can see that it's more flexible. And sometimes in some examples, it can split things perfectly very well. As I said, our example is a little bit harder, but you can see how these things kind of really separated from the other ones. So that's kind of the sense of nonlinear methods. They're more flexible, so they can kind of do stuff. And here I'm just projecting on 2D. So maybe if I have like a, if I still use 30 dimensions, I can have a very good decomposition of wells and non-wells. I just cannot see that, right? That's the problem. Okay, so, and a lot of pictures. Oh, that was the Tisney. Oh, that's a whole cluster here. Okay, I was looking at the wrong plot. Anyway, see how that separated. I don't know why, but it did separate. Anyway, it's more flexible. That's you can learn. Okay, so I'll go to the next notebook. Any questions on dimensionality reduction in general or about the whales? Okay. Let's go to classification. So we're going to do classification of whales. And there are a lot of them, and they sound different. But anyway, we have we actually have a tricky problem because in this data set, there, all the other ones are not quiet. There are other whales talking. So we actually have to distinguish a specific type of whale from the other ones. So that's why sometimes you can see that things don't split very well. All right. So we're going to do the same thing just to make sure we get the data as before. And I'm just going to load these X and Y. So that's all I need to do classification. Okay? And in order to do classification, usually you need to kind of, usually you train on some data set and you test on another data set, right? You have labels so you can test. So we can do this, we can kind of set up our dataset very easily in scikit-learn because we have this train test split function. So all we have to do is we can set some percentage of, we want these ones to be train, these ones to be test, and there's some randomization happening, which is good to randomize because when you're lazy, you just do first half. is trained, second half is test, but did you ask how they were collected and how they were ordered? No, so better do that, okay? All right, so now we have X-train, X-test, Y-train, Y-test. So these are the labels, and this is the data. Okay, so model fitting. So I'll get back to the picture that we have. And actually there is a, so if we get to the classification business, there are like several different options. But I remember from some talk a few years back, somebody showed this picture and they had like a scratch and they said use random forest. So pretty much there's a lot of options, but there are some methods that are generally known to be really, really good. So sometimes people advise to try them out always to make sure that you're not doing something wrong. And I'll discuss, so pretty much I'll mention two methods and we'll try one of them and you can try the other ones. So random forest, as I said, so let's look through this picture actually, let's go through it. So we are somewhere here. We have less than 100K. So the first thing to try is to try a linear classifier. So it's kind of the same like with dimensionality reduction. You don't jump into nonlinear stuff unless you need to. So don't do something complex until you try something simple. So that's why they suggest trilinear support vector machine, which is a popular method which is known to work more or less okay. And then they ask you if it doesn't work, we don't have text data, try k-nearest neighbors, and then if not, you get here, where you can have nonlinear support vector machine, and something they call it ensemble classifiers. So, and here I have random forests. So random forests is an example of an ensemble classifier. There are other ones. So pretty much everybody, I think, understands decision trees, right? Like we decide this well is too big, this well is too loud. You know, we can classify them based on that. So there is actual methods in machine learning, which is a decision tree. So you train it, and it makes this classification, right? So that's pretty kind of, it's usually very interpretable methods. But they can overfit, right? Because they try to fit on every dimension, and it might not work out well. But the good thing is when you combine a lot of these trees, you get random forests, and they turn out to perform really, really, really well. And there are some other ones, which is a gradient boosting method, which has some advantages, but they're all in the same pool that they're usually pretty good. You don't know until you test, but it's worth to try. So that's why we're just gonna jump directly, although I said don't do something complex before you do something simple. But let's just jump ahead, and I'll just show you how to do random forest classifier. And you can try the support vector machine on your own. So pretty much you import it. And again, there are some parameters. So similarly, like with PCA, we have to set the parameters. And all I'm setting is the depth to be 10. Is it right? I don't know. We try and see. And then once you have that, you just do CLF. So this stays for classifier. CLF fit, X train, Y train, and we get something. Okay. So that's all on running them. Running them is easy. Evaluating them, it's not. It is easy, actually. It's gonna be easier. Okay, how do we evaluate them? Anybody wanna say how we evaluate them? I have something called accuracy. What is the accuracy of a classifier? Anybody wanna say? Reproducibility of particular classification. So that's actually, I think it's going to generalizability, right? That it works on other data sets, right? You can repeat it over and over again, and it's consistent. Yeah, that's actually a very good point. And that actually, it's not even getting to that, because in order to get to that, we even need more testing sets, right? Not just one. we split it into train and test. And if we do something on the test, we don't even get a sense of how it acts in general, which is a very good point. So any other thoughts on how to do, what to do? In general, what do you do when you get to this? So what is accuracy? Accuracy, simply we see which how many of the labels are correct, right? So in this context, I know it's a little bit not clear, but this gives us the new labels by the prediction function. Maybe we split it here. So we're going to get zeros and ones from the prediction. We get those zeros and ones and compare them to the true ones. These are the true ones. These are on the training set. Do you care about that? Yeah, so we don't care much, but it better work, right? Because if it doesn't work, it's very possible that the, you know, maybe the method didn't converge or maybe something else happened. So I think it's good to try, just don't get excited if it's high. So train, so they're both zeros and ones, so we can compare all the overlaps, all the differences. So that's why I have this absolute value, and then I do some algebra to get it. Does that make sense, the accuracy? Yeah, how many you got wrong and how many you got right? We got actually quite a lot of right, 93%. Okay, so but as we said, we want to do it on the test. Actually, we want more. We want to see how it generalizes, but let's first see how it works on the test data set. So we do the same thing. We just put here the test, and we get some score, and it's 84 approximately. So it's not that bad, right? Okay, so what more can we learn? One of the things about a random forest is that it's actually a probabilistic method. So here with the predict function, we got y predict was giving us zeros and maybe I should print it. That's giving us zeros and ones, but if we want, we can get a score of how good the zero or one is, what's the chance? So if you use this predict proba, you actually get probabilities. So in a sense, if you're one, but maybe if you're just 51%, then maybe that one doesn't mean so much. So you can kind of reweight things and have a better understanding of what's going on. Also, when we get these probabilities, normally we say the threshold would be around 50%, right? But who said we should cut it at 50%? There's no reason. Maybe for some setting, you can have a threshold at a different place. So the idea is that you can actually start moving this threshold and kind of consider different cases. So this is kind of the standard setup. We're just going to have greater than 0.5. But we could have other options. So in order to explore these other options, there is the receiver operating characteristic curve, the ROC curve. Some of you might have seen it. And there is something called area under the curve. So let's just go through it quickly to remind ourselves what it is. So we get these numbers, and we can decide on a threshold. But we don't know what threshold. So we can move this threshold. And every time we move it, we get different scores. So let's look at the picture to explain it. So let's look at this curve. So let's look at actually this example. So let's say we set the threshold at zero. Then, so we're always going to predict upcall. So if I always predict upcall, pretty much if I have this plot in here, when it is upcall, I'll predict upcall. So I'll be correct, right? So this would be one. And this axis is predict upcall when not upcall. Well, this is 1, 2, right? Because I'm just predicting upcall. So I'm going to be at this point here. Does that make sense? You have to maybe think about it for a second. And then the other option is if we set the threshold to 1, we'll miss all of them because I'm not going to ever say that there is a whale there. And so here I'll be at 0 on this axis. And even when there are no upcalls, I'm not going to say it's an upcall. So it's going to be 0 here. So it kind of pins the two axes, kind of the two edges. And then everything else is in between. And the idea is the more it is in this direction, the better it is, right? So if you have several methods, you can actually plot both of them and decide which method to take based on this plot. And as we said above, I think you can do it on your own. We have the support vector machine classifier. You can try it out and try to plot another curve and see which one is better. But I'll move on just in favor of time. So I want to say a few more important things. Because that's not, unfortunately, that's not everything we need. So that's a good measure. But let's still think about a classifier that if my classifier says if my classifier says never, there is never whale, how good this classifier is. Can you think about that for a second? It always says no. Oh, sorry? When it is not right. So what is the chance of not observing a whale in this kind of setup? Yeah, but there is a, we know how many, we know something about. There's going to be cases when I'm given one of these signals. Some of them are whales, some of them are not, right? There's some chance that they're whales, there's some chance they're not whales. So what is the chance they're being whales or not whales? Can you get this from your data? Any suggestion? Oh, sorry? Yeah, so pretty much we can get a sense from some estimate. I mean, it might not be correct. But from our data set, we can see how many whales we had in that data set. Whether that's going to be the same for the testing data set, I don't know. But let's assume that based on that, we can kind of have some sort of estimate. And if we know something about the, so like now we have the tests, we're kind of in our evaluation stage, so we do have the test data set. So on that test data set, we know exactly how often we'll be wrong if we say always no whales. Because let's do that. So here, this is the number of ones in the test data set. So this is the number of whale calls. This is the total number of values. So this gives us this by itself gives us the ratio of the whale calls. Okay. So this gives us the ratio. This gives us the proportion of no whale calls. So pretty much on that test, if we evaluate it, we're gonna be wrong only 25% of the time. Because in general, there are way less calls than. So that kind of gets to another problem we hit very often with this is kind of like strange events, extreme events. We don't observe them that often, so we're a little bit we get biased to the case that we can always say there is nothing, and you can say that that's a good classifier because 75 doesn't sound too bad. But you're not going to do any science with it after that because it's not that useful. So there are some other measures to look at in these situations. And I'll go through them, because they're important. So we can look at this confusion matrix, which it's easy to confuse us. And I was double checking. I'm not even 100% sure if I got it right. But the main point is to look at all the cases and pretty much what you predict and what you what is the ground truth. And you can kind of look at these percentages and get a sense of, you know, like, oh, how many I got. So I pretty much, I never, so these are all your errors, right? And the accuracy combines all these errors. So it doesn't give you a final number, but if you want to look at them carefully, it's useful to look at the confusion metrics. So for example, when there is no right call, we rarely predict there is a call, which kind of makes sense. If there is no one, you're not going to hear it out of nowhere. But there is a chance that you hear something else and you think it's an up call. But you don't know. So anyway, so kind of exploring these boxes, I think, help you understand what's going on. And so I want to say one thing that I think in the case of one measure that's important in the case of whales, maybe, is like, for example, when we said for the case that we just predict no call, we're good, we have a high score, no problem. What is low is we're never gonna retrieve any. So if your goal is to retrieve some observations, you're never gonna retrieve that. And that is called, actually, did I write it somewhere? Maybe I didn't write. So that's called recall. Recall is from the ones that you're interested in. So this is the class of whales. How many did I retrieve? So that's recall. And then there is another measure, which is called precision, which is when I'm making a detection, how correct I am about this detection. So these are all useful measures, right? If you're going to be like, if you're actually searching for whales, then you want your recall to be higher. If you're gonna have some sort of drug and you're gonna give it to people, then your precision better be higher. Or if you're like identifying like criminals, you don't wanna just go and say they're criminals. You want to be precise in this statement. So it really depends on your problem. So, but it's important to know that there are these other measures. And in the case of unbalanced data set, like we have unbalanced data set, it's better to look at, instead of looking at the ROC curve, which is you can look at it, it's useful to look at also the precision recall curve, which pretty much tells you, and usually the way people do it is you can fix one axis and see, you know, how much you can get for that axis. For example, if I want to have a recall at least 50%, or maybe you fix your precision level and then you see what kind of recall you'll get. So maybe the precision is from your boss. Your boss tells you, we need this kind of precision. And then you get a sense of how much you're gonna get with this precision. Does that make sense? Have you heard, have you used it? I don't know. Have you dealt with precision recall curves? So just remember that, you know, like they come, sometimes people forget about them, but every time you have these unbalanced data sets, you should look at them because they really tell you what you need to know. Does it make sense, at least, kind of in terms of whales? You pretty much consider all the situations. Okay? And in this case, it's, so, and this is average precision, I think the average over all the recalls. So, you know, like, but at least it's not, it's actually not that bad. I've seen way worse. I've seen way worse precision recall curves. And just the final thing I'll say is that the F1 score sort of combines both precision and recall. And people often report it on some presentations. It's less intuitive, actually, because it's just a number that the closer to one it is, the better. But, you know, it's not that intuitive. Okay, and I'll stop with these measures. Just keep in mind that there are all these measures that you kind of have to check and understand what's going on. And here I have like a few extra steps. So for your question, you said that you want to see how it performs, whether it's reproducible. So for now, we just split into test and train. In general, you should do this many times so that you're not biased to your splitting. And you can do this with cross-validation. So pretty much you split one, you split, and then you test, and then you do another split, and then you test. And then you get a sense of the distribution. Now we can talk about statistics. And the good thing about scikit-learn is that we just have a function. That's kind of small. But we just have a function for that, which is here. And it does all this for you. I remember the days before, I had to do all this subsetting to have 500 versions of the data set. It was so confusing. So you should just use this function. OK. So a few other faults, as I said, if you want to play around, try these other methods and just get a sense of which one is better, something like that. It's a simple exercise. The whole problem with shifting, we didn't do anything about it, right? We really treated it as this big vector, which more or less was working, you know, like not ideal, but it was actually giving us something. So regarding that, I have another notebook, which actually I just kind of wanted to point you to that. I'm not going to spend time on it. But if you want to play, so like there's a lot of, you know, like there is a lot about deep learning these days. So if you want to actually kind of understand when it can be useful for you and when not, I think this is a good case, because in this case we know that the time information, you know, like there, we want to account for shifts, right? And there are some methods which deal with this. They are doing like match, kind of like matched filters and so on. But they're kind of a little bit hard to implement, because you have to go and loop through the all the possible shifts. So one example when deep learning can help us is a situation like this. And what is deep learning? OK, as I said, there's tons of methods. Well, just think of it. This is an extra method. How is it special? Well, it has a lot of parameters. But then in this notebook, I just show you how to apply a convolutional neural network to fit kind of the same problem. So pretty much you can have a lot of different setups for this. But the important thing is, because we use convolutions. Convolutions are translation invariant. So at least locally, you get this translation invariance, which we didn't do anything about it in the previous case. So if you want to deal with these kind of problems, most probably it's better to do that. But in that case, it was kind of working not too bad. So maybe if this is too slow, maybe we don't need it. So we still need to evaluate in the end, right? We shouldn't just jump and say it's going to work better. And in cases for spectrograms, so the way I set it up here, I did the Welch filter, and I actually did it on the signals. So I just take a deal with time. But you can do it for the spectrogram and treat it as a picture and have like a spatial translation invariance. So that's another way to deal with it. And that's why these methods work so well with images from Facebook. Because first, they're trained on a lot of images from Facebook. But second, they can account for these translations in those images. So this is, as I'm saying, I'm not going through this. This is for you if you're interested. Pretty much, I want to just show you that it's not that complex. And all you need is you need this library, which is called Keras. So this is one way to do it. There's other libraries. But if you have this library, then you have a lot of this jargon here. And I tried to make a table of the jargon, but there is way more jargon. So my goal is not to clarify the jargon, but to just show you that they're actually simple things. The learning rate is just a time step of your optimization method. The batch size is just the subset you take, you make an estimate, you move forward. So then you cross entropy is your cost function. This is just a special optimizer that they use in these methods. And the convolutional layers are the ones that help us with translation. And the max pooling and average pooling also help us with translation because they pretty much get a few neighboring values and kind of combine it, just get the maximum value. So it makes things more robust to noise. So a lot of names, but in the end, it's not something complex. And if you want to run it, the way you build the models is kind of this sequential way. So you just start stacking a lot of layers. And this is an example of how this network looks like, but there's a lot of other examples. So the main point is that you can get started with this and you can see how it works. So I want to say a few other things. So regarding the running, I'm not going to run it because it's kind of slow. So, but there are several things to look for. So here we have this validation accuracy, and we have the actual accuracy. So in general, when you see this, this will be decreasing because this is evaluated on the training set because they haven't even seen the testing set yet. But this, at some point, might start decreasing because it's a different subset on which you evaluate. So this will tell you that you're starting to overfit your model to your training set. So just keep in mind that you have these two values, and you know, like, you can get very high accuracy on your training set, but you're not going to have very high very high accuracy on the validation set. So these are the two numbers to keep. Even when it is running, if it starts increasing, you can stop it. I'll show you one different solution, which I kind of found out. And cloud resources can help. One of the reasons why they're really going to help you is, first, you can spin up GPUs. As Rob said, they could reach like $16 per one. So like, I think the cheapest one is 90 cents. So you know, there is price there. The advantage of using cloud for this situation is that usually, if you want to use GPU, you need to set up some drivers. It's kind of a hassle to do. So in AWS, people have already done it. So you just take their image, and they even have some images which are called DLAMI, D-L-A-M-I. So like the AMI images we're saving. So they're saved with all the possible deep learning libraries on top of them. So you don't have to do any setup. So that's really nice. Otherwise, on your laptop, you have to set it up. But I found this if you just want to play, which I did. So I said Kaggle is, I got the data set from Kaggle, but Kaggle also has kernels, which can run Jupyter notebooks, and you can use their data sets to play around, try something. But what they have now, I'll just go through this here, is that they have this button which says GPU on, and you get a GPU, and I tested it, and it's way faster than running this here than running it locally. And Amanda says something that I should stop, maybe. I don't know what you're saying. Okay, can you put the link? Yeah, and another one, since we're just adding more. Jake mentioned Collab earlier. Collab also has their own GPU button, so you can try that one too. And for now, they're all in beta, so things are a little bit like this, but they're free. So things can break, but it's free. So I think it's good. Yeah, I think I'll stop here. I think it's just kind of to get you started with exploration and data mining and so on. Do you have any questions? No questions? Time for lunch? Okay, let's go.